What's up, guys? Teddy Cornwell here. Welcome to the Underdog Talk, the most underrated podcast on earth, according to Generation Iron. And there is just something about the underdog. But today, I mean, we have an absolute beast on the Underdog Talk, aka the strongest deadlifter in IFBB history. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, you see himself. In the tank top, muscles popping, the one and only Joe Mackey. What is up, big fella? How you doing today, man?
It's been a crazy day. It's been crazy busy, but I love busy days. But I'm glad I'm here. Thank you for the invite, and glad to be on a podcast. And you've obviously have some great athletes and some great guests on your show, so I'm glad to be a part of it.
Well, welcome to I guess the elite crew. Now, I mean, it's even more elite now that we have you, and I just got a pop-up picture of you and our guy Milosh, who's on the podcast. Shout out Milosh. I
Nice.
mean, ladies and gentlemen, aesthetics alert. Hashtag aesthetics. I assume that was at the Dragon's Lair in Las Vegas, Joe.
It's my first time out there, and that's actually the first time me and Milo's linked up. So it was our first time meeting and training together, and we hit it off really good.
He's a funny motherfucker, I'm not gonna
He
lie.
is. He's still. Oh, he's a good guy. And he's
He is a
I drive Milo. He's every time we're around each other, we're laughing or tripping out or whatever. Even when we're on the phone, man, we're both two goofy motherfuckers too. So.
He is a funny motherfucker. And the funniest, I mean, we had him on the pod, but the funniest is when a co-owner of Gym Supplements, Mike McGurline, was on the show, and he did the funniest Milosh accent. I don't even want to do it, and I can't do it, but I mean, yeah, he is obviously a legend, the mind. And I gotta ask you, because we are now seeing that gym blow up. I mean, we see the pros go there, and pros have talked about training there, obviously, before the Olympia, which was in Las Vegas. But you know, Nick was talking about how he and Andrew would go there, and just all the pros. What was it like? I mean, for someone who hasn't been there.
It was cool, man. It was my first time there as well, and I didn't get a chance to meet Flex. He wasn't there when I went there, but just the energy. I mean, obviously the gym equipment is it's just next level, of course. The lighting anywhere, all the way from the training area to the posing room. They have a just a great posing area as well too. But it's just like gym. I went there actually on a Sunday, so obviously on Sundays it's not too much going on, and I believe that's more more athlete rest day. I know it's one of mine as well. But just in regards to what I did see when I was there, just the equipment, obviously the energy, the music, the poster room, just the whole setup itself, man, it's a win-win. So it's definitely something that I want to go back to. I actually was reached out to Milo's recently, and we should be linking up here pretty soon. Actually, I'm going to go out there and get into the training session and hitting in with him. So you guys can expect that coming here sometime this year in the near future.
And I mean, I feel like I can't stop saying good things about Milosh or Flex. You know, love them to death, and they took a chance on this podcast when we were nothing, showing what characters they are, and showing kind of to me that the sport of bodybuilding and bodybuilders are just a fantastic community. Now, speaking of bodybuilding, and let me ask this question. Don't take any disrespect in this. Are you a power lifter or bodybuilder? I mean, I think everyone is just on the edge. What is the answer to this, Joe?
I mean, it's like what I tell everybody, you don't have to choose one. I mean, when God's giving you a talent like he's given me, to where I can do both and I can look the way I look, obviously, because my whole thing has been, a lot of people don't notice, but, since I was young, as a teenager, I enjoyed lifting heavy. And I was already a big guy that was known for my power and strength back then, before I even start bodybuilding. I was in my 20s. I mean, I was tipping the scale around, when I was bulking up, and obviously I used to bulk up way differently back then. But I remember back then, even at the early 20s, people thought I was a pro bodybuilder because I was, 308, 310 pounds. And, but I was, repping out 500 pounds on bench and squatting heavy, and just the gym I grew up in. It's funny too, because A lot of people don't know this, but a good friend of mine, his name is Ali Tac Tac. He's actually Sarah. You know, she played second place this year, but Sarah, previous Miss Olympia, that's her coach. Me and Ali grew up, you know, when we were as a teenager. So it was him, myself, and a group of other guys that really were just hardcore heavy lifters. And back then it was just about, you know, being big, strong, and lifting heavy. And I trained with some older guys back then that showed me what hard work was at a very young age. So, but in regards to your question, bodybuilder or powerlifter, well, I haven't done a powerlifting show, so it's kind of hard to call me a powerlifter. But doing a powerlifting show is something that I plan on doing this year. You know, and it's one of those questions where it's like, I'm not going to say I don't understand it, because a lot of people don't also know, which obviously a lot of people know about Johnny Jackson. You know, Johnny Jackson was also once known as the world's strongest bodybuilder. You know, I remember seeing that magazine about Johnny Jackson, and obviously with me being from Dallas, Texas, Johnny Jackson was always a huge idol of mine. You know, did people ask him back then, was he a bodybuilder or powerlifter? No, fuck no, because he did both, right? You know, in off season, he was, you know, power. And actually, Johnny did powerlifting meets. And I remember even back then, it was a big standoff with him doing deadlifts and this other guy back then that I just remember hearing. But I know Johnny won, I want to say it's a powerlifting meet or it's just a conventional deadlift event. But obviously, you know, Johnny was known for being, you know, just a thick guy. And, you know, that came obviously from in his off season when he powerlifted. And, you know, just recently talking to Branch Warren about a few weeks ago, a lot of people don't know this as well, too, but Branch Warren was a powerlifter. And Branch,
you told me that?
Branch Warren powerlifter as well, too. And, you know, that's what I'm saying. Maybe it's a new generation now where I had that question come up on one of my posts, are you a bodybuilder powerlifter? And it's like, as far as what I wanted to say, you know, and what I did say was two different things, but it's like, guys, you don't have to choose one or the other. It's like, even if you're not strong, and it's like, if you want to powerlift and you're all season when you're not prepping for a bodybuilding show and or whatever the case is, like, fucking do it. You know, if you want to do a bodybuilding show later in the year, do it. Who says you have to choose one or the other? So, you know, it's it's just like one of those things, man. You gotta, you know, get out of the hole. And I think that comes from people saying, oh, if you powerlift, you know, you can get hurt or lifting all that weight or whatever the case is. And, you know, what about risking your body, building a career and stuff like that? And, you know, the whole nine. But it's like, guys, I lift heavy when I'm bodybuilding, when I'm prepping for a show. I lift heavy in my bodybuilding season. I just lift extremely more heavier when not as, you know, when I'm not prepping for a show. But lifting heavy is one of those things that I do even when I'm prepping for a show. You know, obviously, you know, I've worked with some great coaches. I remember training with Dennis James when I went out and trained with him for a season. And it was fun. I remember the first time him and I trained, and it was, I mean, obviously we did a lot of high volume training. And I remember one of the back movements we did, we were doing T-bar rolls. It was my first time out there. And, you know, obviously, like I said, my power is always high. It wasn't as high back then at that point because I was, you know, obviously leaner and prepping for a show. And I think I was probably about 9 weeks out. And but my strength was still high, obviously, of course. And I remember us training and we did a movement. And at the end of the movement, all he said was, fuck, you're fucking strong. And I just laugh, you know, because it's like, you know, and even like I said, I've worked with some great coaches. I was working with Chad Nichols at that point. So wow. I was working with Chad at that point and hearing the great stories when it comes to, you know, him working with Ronnie. And here's the deal. Like, when you're body build and you have power and you have strength, you use it as a gift because, you know, compared to me being able to, back row, let's say dumbbells, easily, you know, row 200 pounds, you know, and it's nothing to me, you know, obviously, you know, if I'm able to do four sets of 12 to 15 reps with 200-pound dumbbells, you know, which one is going to build more quality tissue compared to me doing, you know, 120s? I can easily do the 200, so I do the 200s. And people will probably see that as, oh, shit, man, like, why are you doing the 200s? You're a bodybuilder. It's like, dude, what the fuck are you talking about? I'm doing the 200s because it's easy to me. So it's like, you know, I'm on a podcast. Like, I have a lot to say about some of the, I have to say it. It's like, and like I said, it's even, you know, I think that's even made one of the questions you've seen or maybe curiosity and stuff like that. And there's no disrespect to anyone or whatever the case is, but some of the questions I see, I know that about it. Some of the questions I see, I think are just bluntly stupid, but I still take it with a grain of salt. And I answer them. But as far as bodybuilder, powerlifter, you don't have to choose either one. And at the end of the day, it's kind of like when I was speaking with Fawad, you know, when I was on his podcast, it's like, whether I prep for a show and I lift light weight, you know, or lighter, or do more reps, guess what? Someone's going to have something to say. Someone's going to say, why don't you lift heavier? If I lift heavy for a lot of reps, someone's going to say, why are you lifting so heavy? You know, it's just like what they're saying when they say, if you buy a green car, someone's going to ask, why do you buy a red car? If you buy a red car, somebody's going to say, why don't you buy a blue one? Like, someone's always going to have something to say. But at the end of the day, guys, you do what works for you. Obviously, you do what makes you happy as well, too. And power is one of those things where it's like, I enjoy it a lot. You know, it's even, you know, I did power not really knowing it would put me, matter of fact, you know, I'm on your podcast, obviously. And I did power not knowing it would make even a bigger name for myself. But I wrote a post about this a couple of days ago. It's like, I'm doing something I enjoy, that I love, that's a passion. And it comes, you know, second nature to me with, you know, the power of, as far as what I'm doing, you know, when I'm lifting and, you know, a lot of, obviously you guys see the videos, like, you know, sometimes the weight is heavy, but for me, and it's not to sound any type of arrogant way or anything like that, but it's just not heavy. Like, you know, I want to say all the time, sometimes, to where it's like, man, you know, if I ever get asked the question, like, man, why do you lift so heavy on this movement? And I'm just like, it's not heavy. It's not heavy for me. Maybe it's heavy for you, but you know, it's not crazy heavy. You know, it's just like when I did deadlifts, the first heavy weight to where when I put it down to where I said, man, that shit was heavy, was 900 pounds. Everything prior to that was not really crazy to me. It didn't really, you know, I always knew I had more, you know what I mean? So, but 900 pounds was the first weight that I did to where I was like, man, that shit was heavy.
Well, Joe, call me a small bitch right now real quick, and also call me a stupid fuck for asking these questions. I mean, obviously, I never thought about it like that because we're so programmed to think bodybuilders can't touch big weights. Touch big weights, injuries. And I never thought about it from the perspective, if it feels good for me, it feels good for me. Fuck you. If it doesn't feel good for you. And you're right. You are right. So I am sorry for doubting you. And thank you for answering that question in a very blunt and true way. Now, people know you as a bodybuilder. People know you as a powerlifter. But what people don't know about you is you started out as a scrawny kid. You started out where I am right now, a scrawny kid. You started out as what you call, and Joe, please don't beat the fuck out of me, you were a nerd.
I was a nerd. A month ago. And when I was growing up, and especially elementary school, you know, I hated working out. My older brother is 2 years older than I am, and my dad, they were I'm not gonna say meatheads, but they enjoyed working out. My dad was obviously strong. We'd go to the gym with him, he would rep 405 pounds out easily. My brother, he was, you know, 2 years older, like I said, and just a great athlete. Now, the thing with me, even though I was a skinny kid, of course, I had heart. Yes. You know, Pee Wee football, and even as a kid, even in Pee Wee football, I was a hitter. You know, I was skinny, but I never was afraid to, you know, lay a hit, you know, or put my shoulder down or put my head down and run someone over. So even as a kid, that was kind of noted from my coaches. And even in Pee Wee football, you know, I started. I was actually on offensive line And I was on offensive line. Skinny little me was on offensive line. Excuse me, I was on defensive line, actually. You know, just I just like I said, I was just determined. But all the way, you know, elementary school to that actually makes me remember this as well, too. But even elementary school, myself and two other players, because we used to play for a team called the Mesquite Longhorns, and we got recruited to go to play for another team for the Pleasant Grove Falcons. And they chose me and like two other players to go over there because we were dominant players. Yeah. And I really remember as a kid, you know, kind of, you know, knowing what that felt like and getting recruited by, you know, another division's coach. And even, like I said, as a little kid playing peewee football, it was a cool feeling. But, you know, with that being said, you know, going into middle school, you know, same thing, played football, of course. Wasn't a big kid or anything, but, you know, I played running back. You know, I did well in middle school and, you know, started the whole nine and had a good season, seventh and eighth grade, of course. And then high school, same thing. I, once again, was not a big kid, but I think it was around, I want to say it was around a 10th or 11th grade, maybe. My brother, older brother, finally convinced me to wear, back then he used to wear these fitted muscle shirts. And, you know, he finally convinced me to wear one. I was like, you know, I was arguing with him up and down. I did not want to wear it, but he was like, man, wear it. Like, you're big. Like, you're, you know, people are going to like it. And I wore it. I had a muscle shirt on. I went to school, and I was somewhat embarrassed. But I remember walking in, and, you know, during the lunch break, you know, people saw my arms for the first time. And they were like, Joe, like, look at your arms, man. Like, your arms are huge. So at that starting point, I was known for being a big guy in high school, not because of my weight, but I was, I guess, you know, my arms and my shoulders are something I had growing up as a kid. And, you know, in high school, my arms, I remember we measured my arms in high school were 18 inches. So.
The fuck?
Yeah, they're 18 inches.
Right now? Oh, yeah. Man, Joe.
And I, at that point, yes, it's like I'm not going to say I enjoyed the attention, but it was cool. You know, when it happened, I remember going back home and telling my brother about it. And obviously, what does that do to you as a kid? It makes you want more, you know? So obviously I started eating more, training more. I left high school to go to college, weighing about 175, 180 pounds, but I was ripped, you know, I was good. And went to high school. I just remember eating a ton, training, working out, lifting heavy. I had a workout partner up there. And all we did was work out, you know, work out, work out, work out. And, you know, I would just eat whatever I could get my hands on. Cause I remember when I went to college, I told myself, I don't care if I get fat. I just want to get over 200 pounds. And I finally hit 200 pounds and I was still gaining easily. And, you know, I've told the story before, but the only thing I was taking supplement was creatine and glutamine and protein. That's back when Muscle Milk came out. So I was taking Muscle Milk, creatine, glutamine, taking tons of creatine. I'm talking about, you know, 10 grams in the morning, 10 grams before workout, 10 grams after workout. You know, it was just like, you know, from what I was told, you know, if you, you know, take too much, you'll just pee it out. But that's what I did. I took a lot of creatine, ate a lot of protein, ate TV dinners, you know, burritos, peanut butter sandwiches. And I just remember checking my weight every day. Every time I checked my scale, like every other day, I was going up a weight like 2 or 3 pounds. So when I came home after a semester, you know, leaving high school, weighing 108 pounds, I remember walking inside of my parents' house for Christmas break. And everyone was just in awe when they saw me, you know, because I guess, what is that, 6 months that went by or something like that. And but my parents' reaction was just priceless. They were like, Joseph, like, what did you do? What happened to you? And I didn't realize it was that huge of a difference. But I went from 175 to coming home months later weighing 245 pounds. And obviously, that's a pretty big difference. So, yeah, everyone saw me. And that was, if you know, it was almost like, you know, that moment in high school to where, like, holy shit, man, like, like, dude, you're huge. And, Yeah, the rest is history after that, man. And even there's more stories after that, of course, too. But it's that's just the start of just how things went. And obviously, you know, I stayed home after that, and you know, continued to train. And that's when I linked up with the guys at the gym and stuff like that. And the rest is history.
And the rest is history. And Mesquite Longhorn sounds like the most Texas school shit I've ever heard in my life. And unfortunately, Joe, in high school, not fortunately, your arms than me now. So it's almost like bodybuilding, powerlifting, whatever the fuck you want to call it, was meant for you. And people often don't understand how important genetics are. Yes, hard work is huge, but people see these people like Joe or people like Arnold or you know, all these people in there, well, I can't be like them. No, these people have superior genetics. I'm going to call it how it is. And you can work your ass off, but you can't be like everyone. Be yourself. So, you know, I just want people to know that, because as a young kid myself, I would look up in these bodybuilding magazines and I want to be like him. You can be different than him. You can't necessarily have as big arms as Joe, you know, and that's just how it is. And now the rest is history for you, because you did make a name for yourself as both a bodybuilder and a powerlifter. And obviously we really kind of started hearing the name is when you were a dark horse, and you know, some people even had you winning the 2022 Tampa Pro. Obviously, you know, I don't think you got the finish you wanted, but you still had a fine finish in there. So what were your thoughts, you know, on the Tampa Pro? And was this a show that you and your coaching staff went into, this is our one shot to go to the O this year?
Yeah, I think that, I mean, that's honestly speaking, you know, every time that we've I'm not gonna say every time, but we'll just keep it with this show. So yes, with this show, talking to Milos, and you know, obviously if you know Milos, you also know he's not a, you know, he doesn't bullshit you. He's a straight shooter. And he'll, you know, he'll never tell you just what you want to hear. But obviously I remember, you know, linking up with Milos and then flying down there, of course. And I kind of hired Milos, probably about, probably about 4 or 5 weeks out from my show. So I won't get into the other thing as far as that goes, but you know, there's a little bit of a change of direction. And then obviously, you know, reaching out to Milos, of course, and it was a great move. Obviously I'm going to be with Milos, you know, going forward, of course, but, you know, I had sent him some pictures and, you know, he saw the pictures, evaluated me. And even from the pictures, he was like, yeah, man, like, you need to do a Tampa. And, at that point I was just looking to do the, Texas Pro. The Tampa wasn't really on my radar. But that, you know, no, like you're going to do the Tampa. So I said, okay. And, you know, we did the Tampa, which was 1 week before the Texas. And, even from the pictures, you know, he was impressed. And I felt like, you know, I felt like I wanted to wow him even more. So I jumped on a plane. I told him like, hey, I'll be down there in a couple of days. I actually want you to see me in person. And, got down there and saw him in person, and, you know, we trained and obviously went to the posing room, and he was wild. You know, he was just like, yeah, you're way bigger in person. So, you know, you're big in the pictures, but pictures, you know, I've heard that most of, you know, my career, that pictures do me no justice. And yeah, when I saw him in person, it was a no brainer. Yeah. And I think he was even saying to where the way things look, which he didn't know me prior to that, but you know, I think before the Tampa, I believe it was a Chicago Pro. He was saying that he would have, now don't quote me on that, but I think it was a show prior to the Tampa that he would have said that if we were working together, you know, weeks prior, that he would have liked me to do something even before the Tampa. But obviously that was over and said and done with. And yeah, we did the Tampa, and you know, Milos is very detailed, and you know, we hit it off real well. We communicated day after day, pictures, the whole nine, the training, you know, obviously with my training style, you know, he agreed with it, of course, with, you know, higher volume and squeezing the muscle and, you know, keeping the weight heavy, which is great, but also make sure the volume is in there as well too. So that goes hand in hand with, you know, like I said, if I'm doing lat pull downs and instead of doing 120 pound with, you know, lat pull downs, like I could do 250 pounds, you know, for 15 reps instead of doing 120 pounds for 50 reps. And obviously, you know, that's going to create, you know, better tissue. And and something I feel like, does it separate when you can lift heavier, you know, for good volume as well too? Absolutely. Yeah. You know, that I believe it creates a grainier physique, you know, just that, you know, physique to where I've seen with, you know, other bodybuilders that have that, just that, you know, for example, you know, take Branch, you know, back in the day, like, that grainy looking physique to where just hard, intense training, you know, with volume. And that's even another story. Like training with those guys, man, I remember training with them a couple of years ago for the first time ever, man, they kicked my ass. Like the first time I worked out with them, they're monsters. I mean, I'm training with them when they're retired. And better yet, just only imagine training with Branch and Johnny when they were in their prime. But man, still to this day, they you know, they put in work. So, and they, when I'm talking about lifting heavy, you know, lifting heavy every movement. And not only lifting heavy every movement, but drop setting and super setting just about every movement as well too. So anyway, we'll get into that later. But you know, I've been as, like I said, I've been doing this for a long time, and obviously I've been around some good people, and you know, just I've had the opportunity of, you know, networking and, you know, having some good friends both in the bodybuilding scene and power scene. And even here's another thing. Here's even another thing I wanna touch on. I see the question, I see the comment pop up every blue moon, and they say, "Hey, why are you deadlifting? Do you want to end up like Ronnie Coleman?" Have you ever seen that comment?
I have not seen that comment.
Okay, I've seen it a couple times. So, and here's the deal when it comes to that comment. If anyone watches the Ronnie Coleman documentary, obviously he'll explain to everyone how things happen with his injury. And obviously, you know, he lets people know that in college, you know, he suffered a back injury when he played for Grambling State. That was the first, you know, problem he had with his back. Obviously, he started bodybuilding, of course, and his back did not get messed up from deadlifting. On his documentary, he quoted when he was doing front squats, those 800-pound front squats. He was going for his third rep, I believe, and he felt a pop. And when he was front squatted over 800 pounds, that's when Ronnie Coleman, you know, did some pretty severe damage to his back. But obviously, you know, Ronnie being who he is, he still trained heavy. And year after year after year, and then even after surgery, you know, with Ronnie, you know, Ronnie's just a beast. And you know, there's, you know, in my opinion, there comes a time to where you kind of have to back off a little bit. You know, it's kind of like with football players, you know, when you're getting concussion after concussion after concussion, but you still continue to get on the field and, you know, season after season, continue to push it. But you know, after that, there's going to be repercussions to you doing that, of course. So you got to listen to your body, you know, and that's something obviously that, you know, obviously I'll always do, whether I'm bodybuilding or powerlifting. You know, if I start getting to a point where my body is, you know, breaking apart, or you know, on the bodybuilding side or the power side, I gotta listen to my body. You gotta be smart. You know, that's just part of the whole plan in regards to, yeah, do what you love to do, but also be smart with what you're doing as well too. Listen to your body.
And John, I'm glad you mentioned that because it, I think we see now more and more. And before I even get into this rant, we had Ed Cohn on the show, the best powerlifter of all time. I'll get you and him in touch because that would be some magic to see. But you know, to Rob and Tua and to all these guys, it and obviously DeMar Hamlin, so glad he's doing well. It's more than a sport, you know. We're human beings, and yes, these sports and bodybuilding, you know, mean the world to us, mean everything. But at the end of the day, we do have families. We have loved ones we got to come home to, and we can't be putting ourselves through that constant pain once it's time for us to kind of stop. And I'm glad that you are smart and understand that because people don't know that. And people, when they, prime example with you, when you're putting up all this weight, people, you know, he doesn't care about his body, Joe, you know, the pain, whatever. And I'm glad you mentioned that, Joe.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's one of the things, you know, it's you know, when I did the row to 900-pound deadlift and stuff like that, I never had any injuries, I never had any problems, never had any complications whatsoever. You know, now I'm back in the groove of, you know, I gotta go to LA tomorrow for CT Fletcher's event, Iron Wars. You know, I'm gonna be pulling 910 pounds this weekend. And yeah, I'm all up for it. It's I'm looking forward to it. It's cool. And it's, man, one thing, you know, if you don't personally know me, it's like, man, I'm a adrenaline junkie. You know, if I'm not lifting heavy weights, you know, it's almost like this. If I'm not bodybuilding, I have to do something. So if I'm not bodybuilding, then I'm going to go to my power building side. I'm not going to say powerlifting because I haven't done a powerlifting meet yet. So I'll say power building. You know, if I'm not power building or bodybuilding, you know, I got to go to my, to the cars where I'm building another fast car or something like that. Cause it's like, I got to have something to keep my blood pumping.
Yeah. And,
you know, that's just how I am. And obviously even years ago, you know, I went back to, a lot of people don't know this, but I went back to boxing. You know, I used to do boxing for, you know, probably about a year. And obviously, you know, if you box, obviously, you know, you lose a good amount of weight. And obviously, I think I probably lost about 25 to 30 pounds boxing, you know, from all the cardiovascular and stuff like that. But yeah, it's that, I'm just saying that just in regards to where it's like, yes, I do not like to sit still. And even with, you know, business, of course, you know, that's even another situation. It's like, you know, there has to be something. You know, even outside of business, because I'm always going to be a business person, of course. But, you know, when business is done for the day or the evening, whatever the case is, it's like, my thing is like, what's next? Either I'm jumping in my car and going to a race, or I'm going to the gym, or I'm going to the you know, the cage, the box, or, you know, depending on what aspect of my life is going on, like, it's always going to be something else, you know, until I get old, until I need to sit my ass down.
I'm not gonna lie, the thought of you in a boxing ring scares the fuck out of me. I mean, I think you could knock me out in one punch. God, bodybuilder and boxing, that should not be allowed. I've gotta say that now. Bodybuilders in boxing should not be allowed. And obviously, we did just see you in the Tampa Pro where you looked phenomenal. And obviously, you were with the mind himself, Milos, who is, I mean, stellar. We saw what you did with Samson. You know, we've seen what he's done, I believe, with Logan Franklin also. I mean, I'm excited to see what he's going to do with you, Joe Mackey. Now, the question is, the million-dollar question is, what is next for you? Do you have a show coming up this year that you're looking to win and ultimately qualify for this year's Mr. O?
So I haven't put a show yet on schedule. Obviously, I've been talking to Milos, and, you know, we just haven't set one. And put it on schedule. Yeah, there's so much stuff.
Yeah,
good things happening all around me. You know, with you know, I can't touch on it just yet, but there's a lot of handful of announcements. You know, I'm going to be making. You know, maybe this month or next month. You know, on what side was this power building, lifting, bodybuilding? That's just something you guys are going to have to wait and see. But it's there are some things for sure that are coming before I do set a date for our next bodybuilding show. You know, it's not to say that yes, I'm not gonna be competing this year. I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying there are a couple of things that I'm gonna knock out prior to me committing to a show this year.
I was sending a prayer because I wanna see you in the show. Because you did go up against three Underdog Talk alumni in Martin Fitzwater, Andrew Jack, and Kamal, and gave them a run for their money. So, I mean, prep, more time with Milos. I mean, oh, man, I want to see you on that stage so bad, yet I also want to see you on the powerlifting thing. I mean, you know how in, I guess, the NFL, someone that can be like a dual threat play, like wide receiver, or the guy at Jacksonville State, like cornerback and wide receiver. I mean, Joe, you're kind of a dual threat. It's kind of damn dope. I'm not going to lie. It gets me a little excited. And you know, what if you just did both in 1 year? I don't want to be ruining or spoiling your plans, man, but you got me thinking. Is boxing involved? Oh, shit, man. You are something else, man. I truly love it. And, Joe, I mean, I've just been honored to kind of sit here and listen to you. I mean, a passion. The emotion, it's stellar, man. And best of luck with you on the CT Fletcher lift. I mean, that's going to be phenomenal. Again, getting your name out there. Now, you've kind of been through it all in powerlifting, bodybuilding, from the start of as a skinny kid with muscles, bigger muscles than me, to kind of getting that IFBB card, to becoming an IFBB pro, to doing powerlifting, bodybuilding, being able to train with one of the best coaches of all time.
Yeah.
I guess two questions. What is your biggest tip for someone who is looking to get into fitness like you once were? And then to add on to that, Joe, what is your biggest tip for someone who's looking to become a professional bodybuilder like you, sir?
It's just like anything that you really want to achieve. It's a lot of hard work, and it's you have to be consistent, of course. It's not for the weak, and what I mean by weak is not physically, I'm talking about mentally. And I think that plays a huge part in anything that you want to succeed in life, to where it's like, obviously I've done a lot of mentoring to young youth, and these are things I speak on because, bodybuilding is one of the things that, just like Arnold used to say, it's a platform that I've used to become successful in other aspects of my life, to where it's like, yeah, when, obviously bodybuilding is one of those things where, yes, it's physically impactful, but it's like when you're tired, when you're sore, and you still have to get up and do cardio, or you still have to go and prep and cook your food, or get all these meals in. That's commitment. That's hard work. Those are things that, you committed to. And that's one thing with me. If I commit to something, there's never been a bodybuilding show that I committed to or that I backed out of because I said, forget this, or this is too hard. And not even when it comes to business or work or commitment when it comes to, a profession or anything like that. And just these are things I learned, obviously, playing sports, obviously from my father as well too. A person can have all the genetics, the talent in the world, but if your mind's not right, man, like the first thing that comes over that gets hard or gets tough, or if you're poked a little bit, then it's like I've seen that so many times as well too, in every industry, in every sport, to where it's like something doesn't go somebody's way and they quit. And so the key, obviously, of what I would say is like, man, like, work hard, and it's mental. Like life can be very challenging at times. Everyone has struggles. Everyone has breakthroughs. Everyone has things that they go through. It's not really. I'm not gonna say the setbacks I've had are any harder than setbacks other people have, but it's like I love hearing stories of where people have had things happen and they learn to overcome it and they become successful. I have mentors still to this day, and I believe successful people have a story. I mean, obviously, unless someone has a trust fund or something like that, but we're talking about someone who's earned it and been there and living it and doing it. And it's just like, let's look at any of the greats in any industry, whether it's actors, whether it's athletes, whether it's just entertainers, whatever it may be, rappers, Mike, one of the, I watch Mike Tyson videos all the time when I'm doing cardio, because it's like, even though Mike Tyson is crazy as hell, but it's like, man, I respect the dude because, just his, everything he seen and went through, and to what he achieved, and becoming the greatest boxer of all time. So it's just, yeah, I could go on and on and on about this, man, for hours, but it's just like, man, just mentally stay focused. Like, man, don't like it's good to have, obviously, good people around you, of course, but sometimes it's not to where you need to depend on others for, to be encouraged or motivated, because that's even one thing I had one guy tell me one time is, he said, and this was an older man too, it's like I wanted to suck shit out of when he said this, because he's like, oh man, you don't motivate me. And I was like, what? And I was like, what do you mean I don't motivate you? And he's like, you don't motivate me. And I'm just like, dude, you're older than I am. And it's like, well, since when did another man need motivation to achieve something that you to me with just for guidance and help? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I've never needed anyone to motivate me for something I'm passionate about or something I wanted to achieve. It's either like you're with me or you're not. If you're not with me, like, peace out. But it's like, when I'm hungry about achieving something, I don't need motivation from anyone because it's like I'm determined. And and like I said, it takes that mental strength to really get things done, because things are always going to get hard. And I can't really think of anything to where, someone wants to succeed in something to where it's just a walk in the park. It doesn't really usually happen like that. So, mental strength, keep it. Use it, apply it, and it's just like These fans might be old and corny, but yeah, when the going gets tough, man, just keep pushing, man. And it's like it'll all be worth it in the end, because it's like Lord knows I've had my struggles, I've had my setbacks, but I'm glad that I never stopped. I'm glad that I never quit, you know, because I'm happy with obviously how things are going now, and it's what it takes.
I'm surprised you didn't 1-2 punch in, Joe. I mean, I really am surprised there. And be patient. Be patient. Yeah. Good things don't come.
Yeah.
Things don't take over time. I mean, for me, I started this podcast 5 months ago. You know, each day there's things I want to do better. But I'm like, well, we started from there.
Yeah.
And Joe, you started from there. Now you're here. And you still have aspirations. You still have goals. And you're going to achieve them. But patience is a virtue. And I'm looking at a quote right in front of the podcast. Focus on giving everything during the process. Results will come with time. I mean,
yeah,
it does not happen overnight. And unfortunately, today's generation needs that instant gratification, myself included. But at the same time, you need to remember, this takes years.
Yeah.
This isn't, okay, well, fuck. I didn't work out today. I'm going to give up. No. That's what makes you want it more. Those days where you're down and the shit kicked out of you. And those are the days that push you to become better. Get back up and go, okay, it's time. Yep. I mean, wow.
Yep.
I got to just pull up this picture one more time. I mean, you are just, you're something else, man. You're really emotional about the sport, which is what I think we need. I think we need to see the emotion.
Yeah.
The hard work that goes in, we see these bodybuilders portrayed as, you know, just supreme beings, but we don't see the work that goes in, that grind that goes in. And I mean, quads on point, biceps on point, abs are just out of this world. Alani, shoulders, delts, boom, Milos with the Jordan shirt. I has that on. Yeah. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, Joe Mackey, the strongest IFBB pro out there. Sorry, everyone else. Joe, it has been such an honor and privilege. Now, before we go, I'm turning the floor to you. Where can we find your content? What are your codes we can use? And what's next for you? Anything you want to plug, the floor is yours, big fella.
Absolutely. So I'm actually going to be making an announcement next week for a new sponsor. So I won't say anything yet. I'll be posting that next week. But outside of that, I definitely want to give shout out to all my, you know, current sponsors that's been with me for some time now. Obviously, Gaz, you know, obviously, they've been with me for, you know, years now. Definitely want to thank Michael Johansson over at Destination, owner of Gaz as well. And want to thank VersaGrips, Heather, you know, she's the person out there running everything. So I called her actually earlier this week so I could get a fresh pair of VersaGrips to go out to California, and they just arrived at my door because I just got a notification. So thank you, Hazel, with VersaGrips. And obviously another shout out to Vivo Barefoot Shoes. Those are the shoes that I wear to the gym and when I deadlift, and they do make a hell of a difference. You know, I would call them, I mean, they're not necessarily power lifting shoes, but it's like I wear them to the store and everywhere because I like the look of them, but also wear them when I'm at the gym too. And it's what I wear for every, you know, PR that I'm doing. That's one thing. Muscle Egg Whites. Those guys have been with me, riding with me as well, too. Love them. And as far as where to find me, I just started my YouTube channel about a month ago. So you guys definitely go click and subscribe to my channel. Teddy, if you could put it up somewhere, that would be great. But it's IFBB Pro. Is it Joseph? No. Okay. IFBB Pro Joe Mackey. All right. Go to YouTube. Click, subscribe. We got a lot of good content coming this year. Obviously, one's coming this weekend with, you know, I'm going to be in LA with CT Fletcher and the whole gang and the whole crew of people out there. It's going to be a good time. And obviously my IG, of course, too. IFBB Pro Joe Mackey as well, too. So follow me on IG. A lot of good things happening this year. You know, I won't spill the beans on a couple of things that I know that are happening, but you guys are just going to have to stay tuned. You know, maybe you and I, Teddy, can get back on the show, of course, too. You know, maybe mid-year, obviously, you'll see and recap back on this one and see where things are at that point and go from there. So it's gonna be a hell of a year. I'm looking forward to it.
And, I mean, we will put that YouTube in the bio. I mean, please go check that out. I mean, I personally am just sitting here waiting to to see Joe and CT Fletcher. I mean, the energy, I mean, guys, is going to be fucking off the chain. First person to use. What is the codes that we can use to support you, Joe?
There are codes. I have some of the codes on my page.
Okay.
Yeah, some of the codes are on my page. Actually, I want to say most of the codes are on my page. So the gas code, and gas is going to kill me for this. I should know my code. No, the gas code is actually JOEM15, all right, for gas. And Vivo, shit. I'm going to have to get back to you on that, actually. So,
okay, gas will win this one. First person to use code JOEM15 on gas. One of the best athletic training gears, and just, I mean, hard work is the motto. Hard work is what kind of creates those that gear. First person to use code JOEM15 on one of their products, send me a screenshot. I will send you a box full of goodies, an autograph from one of the legendary guests that we've had on the podcast. I mean, ladies and gentlemen, go make that happen. Go check out Joe's YouTube.
I challenge anyone, if you do that for, let's see, because I think I have 100 and, because we're at 837 followers. I'm trying to get it to 1,000, obviously, this month, which that's going to happen. So I want to say right now, shit, actually, I don't have anything to give away right now, but I want to say, you guys, when you hear this, go click and subscribe. I need 137 more followers on my YouTube this month. And you guys make sure you go click and subscribe. And Teddy, yeah,
I'm about to do it right now on live here. It is Joe. See what we got on here.
Yeah.
It's right. IFBB Pro Joe Mackey, 847 followers. No questions, all on. I mean, you look pretty damn good in front of that water, Joe. Or that's a football field. Never mind. Guys, check that out. Link will be in the bio. Joe, an honor and privilege. Thank you so much for taking your time out of your day. Best of luck to you this weekend. We know you are going to kill it. And the Underdog Talk fam is fully behind you on that, guys. Go check out Joe's stuff. Follow him. Follow him. Follow him. Till next time, Underdog out.